Yeah, as George already said, I'm a software architect at Cellum. I have been there since 6 years, and I want to tell you an innovation story of how we built a new application in the cloud that is based entirely on a graph database. Yeah, so our innovation story will be based in 3 parts. The first part will be what we expected from our new platform our new product was built on. The second part will be what we actually got. And the third part, of course, the future, where we will go. Yeah, and your edge, as you are in the Atlas track, will be that you can build up on our experience and maybe spare yourself some hassle. Yeah, but let's look. First, for a little preface, so who are we? So we are an enterprise based in Linz, Austria, and our mission focuses on 2 aspects and also 2 products. So the first thing is to help customers in the marketing area to turn content into value. So this means whenever there's a marketing department that has some digital assets like images, videos, and so on, they want to manage this content, they want to find it again via keywords, etc., and they want to be able to publish it to other platforms like YouTube or content delivery networks. That's the first part of our mission. And of course, you also need to create content, and therefore we also, with our new product, a collaboration solution for agile teamwork management called Workrooms, we really want to change how people collaborate. And with this new product, we also launched our new platform that is based on a graph. Yeah, and from the missions for us technicians, challenges arise. And the first challenge is that with our content hub that manages the content, we observe that the users themselves are data modelers, because you might imagine every company has different metadata attached that is important for their assets. So the metadata differs. And on the same, or on the other hand, so to say, they also relate their assets in different ways. So when you have some kind of catalog, for example, you want to link the different language variants of the catalog in different ways, depending on the customer. So we have to accommodate to the different customers by allowing them to model the data themselves. And the second challenge, mainly impacted by our new product, is that we want to support globally distributed teams, and so we need to be able to scale globally. Yeah, back in history, so we started to develop our new collaboration tool called Workrooms back in 2016, and we really decided, because we wanted to change things and really scale, to bootstrap a new platform at the same time. And yeah, we had some expectations about this platform. Namely, as our customers are data modelers, when we also use the new platform for our content hub later on, we need to have customizable data models. Secondly, we want to implement the concept of reactivity. And reactivity means that on the one hand, we want to get data as fast as possible to the user so that the application really feels snappy. And on the other hand, when things break down somehow and the server is under high load, we want at least allow the user to still work with the system. So maybe with less details, but that he still gets the important data first so that the user can work. And finally, as said before, we need to support scalability. Yeah, so small view about our collaboration product called Workrooms. What can you use it for? Well, you can actually use it to make it to this conference here, because it allows us to coordinate via tasks, to plan the journey, to plan the attendance, and to finally, as some kind of output, generate the presentation. So this is what you can use it, agile teamwork, whenever you need to get stuff done, involving people working on files, coordinating themselves via tasks. Yeah. And I also use this product as an example how we work with that platform. So we began by jolting down somehow and drawing our domain. And once again, we see we have some people here that work together on projects that are called workroom in our case, on workrooms. And those workrooms, we only have the file aspect here, can have files in them where people work on them. The files have attributes like a file size, like a file name, and they may be organized within folders. Yeah, and then we said, okay, this kind of data modeling feels intuitive and calls maybe for some kind of graph database. And the second expectation then we had was that we really wanted some kind of fast local navigation. So once again, when we look at the folders, we really want, when we browse a folder, we want to quickly retrieve the files as well as the thumbnails so that the user really can use the app in a snappy way. And finally, we also dreamed of loading some stuff on demand to be even better. So for example, to prefetch some detail data so that when the user wants to know more details about the file, it is immediately available. Yeah, what did we get? An architecture, maybe. So and looks a bit complicated at the first sight, but the architecture itself consists of three major parts for our discussion here. On the one hand, we have, once again, a state-of-the-art UI framework in the front end based on Angular. We have a reactive stack between based on Rx, Java, and Vertex. And finally, we have a graph database. And if you want to know more about the other aspects, like front end or the reactivity itself, then have a look at our blog. Otherwise, I will now focus more on the data aspect. Yeah, and I also want to coin the term full stack reactive that we quite often use and describe what we understand about full stack reactive. So on the right side, you see our Workrooms app. On the left hand, you see some kind of graph database. And we have a so-called reactive communication channel. And what we now wanted to do is that we just say, okay, we start the query, namely to return us all workrooms for our overview. And once we have done that, we want to render the results as quickly as possible. And so whenever the database finds some element that matches the query, it immediately streams it to the front end. And the front end, if the data is sufficient, can immediately render it. And finally, the query finishes and sends a completed message. So this is the key aspect. And when we do that more practically, we just think once again about our overview page and now consider that either we are doing some kind of slow motion discussion, or the server is really slow for some reason, or the internet connection is bad, then we can say, okay, the most important thing for the user to navigate on and to work is to really get the name of the workrooms so that he can close, for example, connected data landen. And then it's not that important that a bit later detailed data, like the other contributors to the workroom, or some stats about the number of files and tasks inside are rendered, because this is secondary data, and we really want to push the data, the important data first to the user. So this is what we understand under full stack reactive. Yeah, our ecosystem, a bit more technical. Once again, we are a browser-based app that communicates with our Xelum persistence layer in the backend. And the Xelum persistence layer, in a nutshell, provides a typed graph of elements and relations that can be queried dynamically. And the typing here is denoted by using different shapes and different arrow styles. Below that, we build up on a graph database called GenusGraph that interfaces via the Apache Tinkerbob and Kremlin standard API. And GenusGraph itself provides us graph navigation, graph analysis via Kremlin, and does this in a rather untyped way compared to our layer that is set on top of it. And Janus Graph itself only provides the Graph API, but also needs a storage backend where to actually store the data of the entities and of the relations. And this is, in our case, Apache Cassandra. And Apache Cassandra provides column families to store data. And in a simplified way, you can imagine it like that, that every entity has a kind of ID, and then the binary data, the attributions, the attributes and the relations are stored as binary data in there. Yeah, but I don't want to talk about Janus Graph now because I already did it, and I also don't want to dive into Gremlin details. So there's a talk on YouTube. It's in English available. If you have more interest, you can enjoy it. Yeah. Going on with the Cellon persistence layer, it provides two aspects. The one is an entity data model. So this is really a model that describes which types of elements can be available in the graph and how they can relate. So for example, we have here the circle up there and we have the rectangle, and it says, okay, it can only be connected via a specific relation type, otherwise it would be invalid. And from this, unless we have some bugs, we can also infer that the actual graph data must comply to this. And on the other hand, we have a query and modification language that allows us to write to the graph and to retrieve data. And retrieving data, you can just imagine a graph query, something like a kind of shape here. So I want this circle connected via this relation to something which is a rectangle, and the circle having a specific ID. And then I can apply the query as a kind of a filter, and I get back the resulting subgraph from the graph database. Yeah, how do we define models? Well, first out, we start just on paper, on whiteboard, and discuss how a model should look like. So we say, okay, we have here some kind of folder that contains files, and maybe we can do some abstraction like a content item which unifies the properties of a folder and of a file. The next thing, when we got more confidence here, is that we derive a technical model definition. We do this via the Eclipse modeling framework, and so we can, in a kind of point and click manner, define the model within Eclipse based on the modeling framework. And the next nice thing we can do is that we then can review the model by generating via Plant UML a diagram of our whole application model, and then we can see how it fits with the rest of the existing application. Yeah, and finally, once we're confident here again, we can generate Java and TypeScript code that can then be used in our queries and modifications. So what actually happens is that we really get some kind of type hierarchy here. So we have the content element type, we have files and folders, and we also have the attributes available here, and it's all generated code. Yeah, next thing is our query and modification language that is built on top of Gremlin. So here you have some Gremlin snippet that says, okay, give me all folders. Would look something like that if we formulated it in our architecture with Gremlin. What we do is that we put a type safe layer on top of that. So the goal was really to make people in our company familiar with the graph and to really guide them when writing queries. And as you can see, the IDE can really suggest how the query can continue in a sense-making manner. Yeah, we have type inheritance, like with file and folder and content item I showed before. We embed common functionalities like cascade delete, for example, and security concerns and permissions built in right into our query language and EDM layer. And we provide this not only on the back end, but also on the front end, so that you can really start type safe queries right from the front end. Yeah, how does a query look like? Looks like that. Once again, for the Kremlin enthusiasts, a Kremlin translation. And this query just lists us the contents, the direct contents of a specific folder. And when we look at this in our graph, we just say, okay, first we start from all folders, then we restrict the set to the folder with a specific name, namely pictures, and then we navigate the relation container has elements so that we go to the files and folders within that folder. Yeah, that's nice. And just want to show you how, on a high level, how we achieve static type safety. And this works by, on the one hand, using really builder style classes here. So we say, okay, start with a static method on query. We say we want to start from all folders. And from this, the compiler can infer two things. On the one hand, of course, through the return value, he knows the next builder and can maybe also restrict the number of operations that make sense, because some operations only make sense on relations, others on entities. So it can really guide the user or the programmer here. The next thing is the compiler can infer also the type, because now he for sure knows we must be standing at a folder at the current traversal position. The next thing is we do the same thing again. We know that still after the restriction, we only restrict down, we are still at standing at folders. And then we say, okay, we follow the relation of a certain kind. And via this relation, the compiler also knows that we now must stand at the content element that can either be a file or a folder. And finally, we say, okay, that's it. We are confident here. And we want to build that stuff. And now we have a query object. And now this query object can be, so the query object itself now ensures, so to say, that the actual data within the graph database must be compatible and fulfill the constraints of types that we specified here, because the EDM itself ensures that. And then we can translate the query to serializable steps and push them over the wire to the backend. Now, if things go wrong, then it is in the first place the compiler's job to prevent the developer to compile the query itself and to commit the code actually then. Because as he knows about type safety, he can already reject a wrong query, for example, when we navigate into the wrong direction. It will detect it. The error message is not the nicest, but you can then think about it. Yeah, and it was my job to actually teach the compiler this by using Java generics. It's quite complex, but if you have a nice evening one day, just read that in-depth blog article about it, and yeah, then you know how it works. Now, we are back at the back end. We get in the steps, the serializable form of the query, and have a look at the pipeline. And the first thing the backend might do is split the query to ensure even more reactivity, because probably multiple queries would be faster to deliver the result quicker. Then it is optimized for index usage, etc., and also based on the EDM, so to remove some redundant filters and so on. Then we finally go to translating it to the Kremlin layer, to a Kremlin script or query. And of course, as it is also available on the front end, we have to embed also some security-related checks to only return the entities that the user might see. And then we actually start the traversal that fetches the data from Cassandra. And whenever we find an element that really should be in the result set, we emit it to the wire over the reactive channel once again, and this goes on and on. And the frontend then can dynamically construct an object graph and render it once again as soon as it makes sense. Yeah, for modifications, it's quite similar. I only want to point out two aspects here. The first thing is, as we have a rather central layer here, we really know what's going on. We know about all grad operations, which elements are created, which elements are deleted, and so on. The next thing is actually that we can implement constraints, because Janus Graph, together with Gremlin, allows us to embed arbitrary Java code. So we have just the common pattern. We can say, OK, I go here, I inspect the data, the current element, and if I'm unhappy with a value, for example, in case of a constraint, I just can throw an exception. And this then happens here, and it doesn't commit back to the database, and we have effectively the possibility to build constraints. Yeah, finally, because we had a very own layer, or have a very own layer based on the graph database on top, we also built, based on open source components, a small tool set to actually query the database and fix things and inspect things. So we have here a code editor and can actually define the queries and then actually execute them so that you can really see the graph and also browse the whole graph. Yeah, our learnings from that. We really came from a classical relational database world and weren't accustomed to replicating data, but now we saw really with performance and so on, you need to replicate data if the use case demands it. It's totally okay. Combined with the finding that relations should really be first-class citizens because they really express the relation between the entities, how they fit together, and they can also be utilized to actually reduce the number of visited entities, because when we replicate some data from the entities on the relations, we don't need to navigate to irrelevant entities, and this also improves performance. Yeah, the next thing is with our reactivity, the granularity of results really matters, and we also found that the reactivity, the fine granular reactivity of having one element by one element doesn't always make sense, because sometimes you have some blocking operations and some elements really follow very closely on the timeline. And so, also with the RX library, we can really improve performance, both for transmission overhead and for client-side rendering, by combining elements, emissions that are near on the timeline. Yeah. And then the main question, as always, is often hearing, can I run this on any graph database? And the answer for now is not that easily, because the thing is, we have here custom Java code that integrates into the Janus graph instance that runs within our JVM. However, other graph databases do not support the embedding, and they expect actually pure Gremlin to be transferred to the graph database server. And we also did already some investigations here, and the main learning is, yeah, you have to write some things differently, but on the other hand, the API shields the usages from experiencing too much negative effects by that. Yeah, where do we go? Well, even more to the cloud. So we really observed, okay, for high performance, you need to go into the direction of eventual consistency. And distributed cloud databases. And we found, okay, we still believe in the model. And what the model should allow us now is to control the redundancy so that data is really replicated where we need for the performance in a manner so that the developer does not have to think about it because it's specified within the model. And the other thing is we also want to think more about schema evolution to really have seamless updates and to allow the customizability per user or per client. And finally, we want to revisit our model of constraints because we still believe in not allowing invalid data, inconsistent data into a database in the first step, but at the same time with eventual consistency, it still might happen due to concurrency. And so we also think that we can derive by analyzing the constraints automatically some kind of cleanup steps that then will eventually bring back the database into a consistent state. Yeah, and an upcoming topic is that we deal with live queries, and live queries basically allow the user to always stay up to date. So now imagine a user has opened a folder with files. Now he collaborates with another user, and another user adds a file there. And what we want to achieve is that as soon as the other user adds the file there, the first user immediately sees the file without refreshing stuff, refreshing the browser, and yeah, really to improve the user experience on the one hand, and on the other hand, of course, by avoiding polling to reduce the server load. Yeah, and this was not done by ourselves alone, but we also had a collaboration with the Johannes Kepler University Linz, and a student wrote his bachelor and master's thesis there. And it's still going on a bit because until we have it in production. So stay tuned because we will blog about it on selom.com on our tech blog. And yeah, this is now the end of our innovation story. So we constantly keep extending the platform according to our claim, always ahead, so to always improve stuff. And I say thank you, and that's the end of the presentation at the start of the discussion. The scale. As the product is quite new, it's not that high now, but what you can observe is actually that we have a lot of local data structures because you have those workrooms where some smaller groups of people work together, and those workrooms go up to, I would say, 10,000 files or something like that. But the nice thing is really you have different entry points, and so it's quite distributed, the data set itself. Okay. Well, the thing was that in the beginning we were not entirely sure if we would move only to the cloud and also provide on-premise. And therefore, we wanted to have a solution that would also be cheaper for customers that want to install on-premises due to license restrictions. So we settled for Clenoscraft because it's quite generic and has different backends. But as said, we are now also evaluating other cloud-only databases. Our main motivation actually is operations concerns. So we think of using managed services to reduce operation effort. Clenoscraft itself should scale, but you have to think about how you provision the stuff.
Actually, I also had a question on that.
Okay. No, actually not. It was because of the scalability promises, so that we have, that we could scale them later on. Because you can also have better consistency guarantees with Clenoscraft when you use other backends. But Cassandra itself provided the best sweet spot of scalability.
Yeah,
so when we talk about files, the binary data is stored somewhere else, but it's all about the metadata, so the actual metadata in the database. And this actual metadata is stored within Cassandra. And Janus Graph provides the traversal and fetches the data accordingly from Cassandra.
Janus Graph is like an additional layer that can work on top of many backends, and Cassandra is just one.
Do you have any problems with
bad performing branding? Yes, we had, and this also inspired our learnings. So, and the main learning, maybe that I can show here, is actually this, namely using the relations as first-class citizens with replicated data so that we really can avoid loading too many entities, because this always means going to Cassandra, fetching new data. But they also observed it's the same, for example, with Cosmos DB. So it's really, you really have to think as soon or as long as it is not a whole in-memory database, you always have to think about the backend and keeping paths short to really have fast responses. Yes, we have some kind of monitoring there, because basically you can analyze how long does the query run, and then say, okay, the user must not now add other queries because he is already consuming resources.
Did you ever consider Spark
Sparkle. I know about Sparkle, but we saw it more as an open data, connected data approach, and not so much for the closed world, so to say, of a product. But in the end, it's all graph traversals. So, and once you get one concept, you can easily switch it to another language, maybe. Yeah, so it was some kind of informed decision, because when always you derive a new solution, you have only limited time to investigate, and it looked good to us and also proved up until now. And now we say, okay, maybe managed services, and now we evaluate further. And the main benefit is really that we have that abstraction layer that we can adapt, and the application does not break. Yes. Yes, it's a general rule, because we can really analyze the content of the queries, and as we said before, brings it back to this picture again. I can know and see how far we want to go into the graph, and if I see, okay, this element is for sure into the result set, and there's a huge evaluation would need to take place, then I can say, okay, let's already omit this one and do this other stuff in a separate query. To deliver it as details. So for example, counting the number of files in a workroom, which can be quite huge. So, but it's generic, yes. Okay, thank you.